We're looking at different ways to tackle the giants that we face in life. Last week we talked about having faith in the face of giants. This morning we're going to talk about tackling the giant of loneliness. I think it's one that we all have to face at one point or another during our lives. I have a friend who's a psychologist, and a few years back he was looking at all the different patients that he was serving, and he wanted to try and come up with one particular ailment that was common to, if not all of them, then most of them. And he spent a few hours looking at his case management books, and he decided that the number one malady that he was treating was loneliness. Many people try to escape loneliness in different ways. Some people get married to avoid loneliness. And some people get divorced to avoid loneliness. But I think there are some common causes of loneliness, and I want to talk about a few of them. I think Paul points them out in this passage. You see, Paul was in prison. He was sentenced to death, and he was waiting for his sentence to be carried out. These may have been some of the last words that he wrote. I think it's kind of strange that they were included in the canon of Scripture, because it's mostly personal stuff, like make sure you grab my books and my coat. But I think if we look carefully within them, we can find some nuggets of gold to help us overcome loneliness. But I think there's some common causes. The first common cause of loneliness is during transition or change. When we're experiencing change in our life, we can feel very alone. Popular Psychology did a survey. They wanted to discover who the five loneliest groups of people in America were. And these are the top five loneliest groups of people in America. Coming in at number five, college freshmen. You wouldn't think that. You would think, oh my gosh, they're off on this great big adventure of their life. They're going to go and live in the dorms and meet all these people, but they're experiencing a huge transition in life. They may be away from home for the first time. They've left all their friends. They have all these new responsibilities, like having to do their own laundry. And they suffer from loneliness. The number fourth most lonely group is folks who are going through a divorce. The third loneliest group in America are single moms. They're working and trying to take care of their children, and they just don't have time for friendship, and so they find themselves lonely. The number two group was stay-at-home moms, because they found themselves isolated away from other adults because they were stuck at home all day with their little ones. And the number one loneliest group in America is seniors. They're transitioning in life. They may have recently lost a spouse. They may have children who are either too busy to spend time with them or who live too far away. They may have outlived many of their friends, and they find themselves isolated, either because of self-imposed isolation or maybe because of health problems. So I think it's important that we are careful when we're experiencing transition or change in life, because it's an opportunity for loneliness to invade. The second common cause of loneliness is being distant from close friends. I discovered this a few years back when we moved to Florida. We moved 3,000 miles away from all of our friends. And when we got to Pensacola, we didn't know anybody. And there's a big difference between Skyping or texting your friend and being able to go out and golf with them on any particular Saturday that you choose. Look at what Paul deals with. Crescens has gone to Galatia. Titus has gone to Dalmatia. Priscilla and Aquila were now engaged in their own ministry. Erastus was in Corinth. And Trophimus was sick in the town of Miletus. And everyone except for Luke had left him. When we find ourselves distant from close friends, we can find ourselves alone. The third common cause of loneliness is when we're facing opposition and or rejection. When you feel like you're the only one that's standing up for what's right, you can feel very alone. Or when people oppose you for what you're standing up for. Sometimes people oppose you for your very core beliefs, And when you find yourself rejected because of those beliefs or opposed because of them, you can find yourselves very alone. Paul says that Demas deserted him and has gone to Thessalonica. And Alexander did a great deal of harm. He strongly opposed our message. It's nice to know that even the Apostle Paul had trouble with the people in his church. He says, at my first defense, no one came to my support, but everyone deserted me. When we feel opposed or rejected, we can feel very alone. The fourth common cause of loneliness is during certain times of the year. Anniversaries happen and we feel alone because of them. Certain holidays make us feel very lonely. When I was associate pastor, interim pastor at Davis Community Church, the eve of Christmas Eve every year, they had what they called a Blue Christmas service. And they invited everyone in the community who really didn't particularly like Christmas because it made them feel sad. And I went to the service, and it wasn't a very happy service. But it was an opportunity for people to say, yeah, you know what? Christmas makes me feel blue. Sometimes you can suffer from seasonal affective disorder. I know this very well. I'm from the Central Valley of California, and from about the middle of December until about the middle of February, the entire valley gets socked in with fog, and you can't see to the end of your driveway sometimes. Sometimes it goes for over a month. One year we had 9 solid weeks of fog. Man, that gets to you. I discovered about once a week or so I needed to drive up into the foothills where the fog wasn't and the sun was and just sit in the sun for a couple of hours. These different things affect us. Sometimes being away from family can affect us, but I don't necessarily know that it should. I saw a poem that was written and it goes like this. I've seen the lights of Paris, I've seen the lights of Rome, but the most beautiful lights I've ever seen are the taillights when the grandkids go home. Sometimes being alone can be a blessing. Paul says, do your best to get here before winter. Sometimes different times of the year can make us feel lonely. And finally, I think that we're subject to loneliness when the future looks dim. Paul says, as for me, my life has already been poured out as an offering to God. The time of my death is near. Now, you may not have experienced all of these things. You may not even have experienced any of these things, but I will bet you lunch at the drive-up window of your choice that you'll experience them at some point during your life. And how we respond to these situations is key. How we respond to these situations where we can find ourselves lonely is key to overcoming and tackling the giant of loneliness. So how do we tackle the giant of loneliness? I think there are 5 steps that are outlined here in this 4th chapter of 2 Timothy. First, we need to respond in healthy ways. We need to respond in healthy ways. When I was younger, I had a friend who was going through medical school, and they required her to do all these different community service outreaches, and she worked in the suicide hotline, and she worked a bunch of different places. For about a month, she worked at the poison control hotline. And she said there was this one lady who called and said, my daughter has swallowed a bunch of ants. Will she be okay? And she said she could have just said, yeah, the ants won't hurt her. Have a nice afternoon, and hung up. But she said there was something in this woman's voice that didn't seem quite right. So she investigated a little further, asked some more probing questions, and she found out that in order to kill the ants, the woman had fed her daughter some ant poison. Ladies and gentlemen, that's not a healthy way to respond. We need to be careful how we respond in these situations because sometimes we can do unhealthy things. I think there are a few roots that we need to refuse or avoid in order to respond in healthy ways. I'll give you 3 of them. First, we need to refuse the root of bitterness or retaliation. We need to not be bitter or retaliatory. If we're lonely and when people approach us, we're just bitter and we retaliate against them, it's only going to drive folks further away. Who wants to be around a mean, old, bitter, retaliatory person? Paul said, "No one stood by me, but don't hold that against them." You got to respect Paul for that statement. Most of us would go, "No one stood by me. I hope they burn in hell." But Paul says, "No matter what people do to me, I'm not going to get bitter." When I was a kid, we had those rock polishers. Remember those? It was a little tumbler that went around and around and around for about a month, and all the little kids hated it because we didn't want to wait a month. We just wanted to have polished rocks. Well, I remember about once a week or so, you had to put a different kind of grit in the tumbler. And at the beginning, you'd had a bunch of old, ugly rocks, and at the end, there were these beautiful polished stones that practically looked like gems. A wise man once said, "Life is full of grit, and whether life grinds you or polishes you is your choice." We're all going to experience different kinds of grit, and it can grind us up or it can polish us. We need to not choose the route of bitterness and retaliation, and we need to refuse the route of self-destructive choices. Some people respond to loneliness in self-destructive ways. They have affairs, or they take drugs, or they drink too much, or they throw a pity party. These things are not healthy responses. Paul says, "Bring the books and the parchment." Sometimes I think if we do constructive things, it helps us through our loneliness. Now, I know that all of you have had exciting things in your life that you could share. I think you should write them down. Paul said, if I'm going to be alone, what the heck, I might as well write most of the New Testament. If you've got exciting stories to tell or an exciting family history, write it down. Write a book. It's easy. I've written 11 of them, and look at me. Write the great American novel. I even wrote a novel. It's not very good, but I wrote it. It's trite, but true. Sometimes we need to make the best of a bad situation. Don't choose destructive choices. And third, we need to refuse the route of isolation. Paul says, "Get here as fast as you can. I need somebody." Do you know that people who live an isolated lifestyle have a 2 times higher risk of mortality than folks who live among friends? There was a classified ad in the Sacramento Bee that I saw a few years back. It said, "Lonely? I'll listen to you for half an hour for $10. And if you want me not to comment, it's $20. I called this guy. He was making money hand over fist. People just needed somebody to listen to him. He wasn't a psychologist or a psychiatrist or any kind of psycho whatever. He just listened to people. We need to not choose the route of isolation. We need to make healthy responses. Secondly, we need to focus on God's presence in our lives. Paul says, "The Master stood by me and helped me." Paul doesn't focus on his Paul's in prison. All his friends have left, either for good or for bad reasons. The only one left is Luke. He's about to be put to death, but he focuses on God's presence. He says, "The Master stood by me." This passage in Hebrews is a nugget that I hope that you'll save. It says, "For he himself has said, 'Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you.' So we say with confidence, 'The Lord is my helper, I will not be afraid.'" Perhaps the most beautiful thing about this passage is the lack of qualifiers. It does not say, "If you're a good Christian, I will never leave you." It doesn't say, "If you follow all the rules, I will never leave you." It simply says, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. Ladies and gentlemen, when we find ourselves lonely, we need to focus on God's presence in our life because you know He's there. You see all the little signs. But it's too easy to focus on all the bad things we see around us. Instead, focus on God's presence and begin to see how He's working in your life. Third, we need to focus on, and if you haven't written anything else down on your little outline this whole time, write this one down. We need to focus on serving. Paul says that they helped me spread the message loud and clear to those who had never heard it. Ladies and gentlemen, if you want to tackle the giant of loneliness, get your eyes off yourself and focus on other people. Don't have a pity party, have a regular party. Paul could have said, "This is how they treat me after all I did for them." But no, he says, "What a great opportunity for me to witness to those who are my jury. What a great opportunity for me to write the words of the New Testament." We need to look at the opportunities that we have for serving others, because when our eyes are focused on ourselves, we get lonelier and lonelier. A wise man once said, "Serving is always better than sulking." Serving is always better than sulking. The happiest people at this church are the folks who are serving. Whether they're the VCRs that help in the middle of the week, or the folks that greet you on the way in, the ushers who hand out things, the guys who are working on keeping the flower beds neat and clean, those who are handing out cookies on Sunday morning, those who are serving are joyous. Because when you put your eyes on someone else, you fill your heart with joy. George Bernard Shaw said, "This is the true joy in life, having a purpose recognized by yourself as a mighty one, being thoroughly worn out before you are thrown on the scrap heap, and being a force of nature instead of a feverish, selfish little clod of ailments and grievances, complaining that the world will not devote itself to making you happy." How true is that? A joyous life comes from having purpose. A joyous life comes from making things better, not only for yourself, but for other people. The people who are the least happy in the world are the ones who sit around going, "How come nobody's here to help me?" We need to focus on serving. When you get your eyes off yourself and help others, you can begin to tackle the giant of loneliness. The fourth thing we need to do to tackle the giant of loneliness is to allow God's word to give us hope. We need to allow God's word to give us hope. Paul says, "Bring the winter coat I left in Troas with Carpus, also the books and parchment notebooks." He wanted him to bring the books so he could have something to read. Okay, if I had a buck for every time I said it, I wouldn't need a buck. But I keep telling you, ladies and gentlemen, you need to read the Bible. Not because it makes me a better pastor when you do, but it makes your life enriched. Look at what it says in Psalms 27. "Even if my father and mother abandon me, the Lord will hold me close." What a comforting thought. Even with everyone else gone, I have the Lord by my side. And in Isaiah 41, it says, "Do not fear, for I am with you, says the Lord. Do not look anxiously about you, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. Surely I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." Ladies and gentlemen, there's no other reason to read the Word of God than to discover these kinds of nuggets for your life. You need to be reading the Bible. I hope you have some kind of a regular plan where every day you read a little bit. And I also hope you're reading one you can understand. On her 91st birthday, or 91st Christmas, Tracy and I bought her grandmother a copy of the Message New Testament. That's the translation I read from a lot. It's written by a guy named Eugene Peterson, a good Presbyterian minister. And a couple of months later, when we were visiting her, she said, you know, I just want to let you know that for the first time in my life, when I read the Bible, I understand what it says. Don't get me wrong. If you've been reading the King James Version your whole life, God bless you. But it's a terrible translation, not because it's not God's word, but because it was written, it was translated about 600 years ago. So the study that we've done over the last 600 years helps us better understand the original languages. Plus, it was translated from the Hebrew into the Greek, into the Latin, and then into the English. And it's that really old thee and thou English stuff. And there are some really, really bad translations. Make sure that if you're going to read the Bible, you read one you can understand. If you have a smartphone or an iPad or one of them pads or one of them electronic devices where you can go online and download a free Bible app, do that and then get the Message translation. If you're not an electronic person, you can find the Message Bible at Walmart or any other Bible store. Make sure you get one you can understand, and by all means, read it, because it will enrich your life. Finally, in order to tackle the giant of loneliness, we need to choose community instead of isolation. When all these people left him, Paul could have said, "That's it. I'm never trusting anybody again." He could have built a wall around himself and just cut himself off and been cranky and grumbly until he was finally put to death. But instead he says, get here as fast as you can and bring Mark with you. He'll be my right-hand man. You see, he was still planning to do things. Even though he had been given a death sentence, even though he knew his life was very short, he still wanted to do things. Many of you say, well, there's not anything I can do. I'm old. Well, if your brain still works, you can pray. I don't know that there's a more valuable mission for the church than to pray. Harvard professor Robert Putnam wrote, "Americans as a whole don't volunteer. They don't join clubs. They don't know their neighbors. They don't trust each other and otherwise neglect the basic needs of democracy. The result? A nation of strangers who are increasingly unhappy, alienated, crime-ridden, and ever sicker." Boy, how true is that? Find something to get involved in if you're lonely. Even if you wanted to, like, go to a Trump rally, that's okay. Just do something. We got to do something to get involved, because the opposite of loneliness is community. God proclaimed at the beginning of creation, when he made Adam, it's not good for man to be alone, and it's still true today. Three chapters later in that book of Genesis, when Satan begins to tempt Eve, where does he catch her? Alone. And about 40 books later in the Bible, when Satan is tempting Jesus, where does he find Jesus after being in the wilderness for 40 days? Alone. If evil is going to tempt us to destroy our own lives, it's going to do it when we're alone. Do your best to not be alone, because that's when we're the most vulnerable. There's a reason that I keep pounding on this get involved in the church stuff. Not because I think our church needs your involvement. It's because I think you need your involvement. We were created to do this stuff together. Find something. I don't care what it is around here. If there's a, let's say you're a flag person and you like to make sure the flags are all nice and neat, then by golly, you be the best flag person possible. But find something. Get involved. Because when you do, you'll discover that you're less lonely. To tackle the giant of loneliness, I've got to respond in healthy ways. I've got to focus on God's presence in my life. I've got to focus on serving because that's where I'll find my true joy. I've got to allow God's word to give me hope, and in order to do that, I've got to read it and make it be one I can understand. And finally, I need to choose community instead of isolation, because we are much better together than we are by ourselves. Ladies and gentlemen, the giant of loneliness is easy to tackle. You just gotta get out of your couch